Right. Oh, it's recording.
Hi, guys.
It's your Hi, guys.
It's again Tiffany and Cindy. And today, you know, we love our special guest. Today, we have four men with a group entitled The Course Correction. And so, what we're going to do today is delve into the mind of the minds, I should say, of four Black men who will discuss a variety of topics. So I'm going to turn it over to Damian Patterson so that he can introduce himself in the group and just let us know a little bit about who the core, what the course correction is and what you guys' mission is.
Okay. So hi, I'm Damian Patterson.
Hi, Damian.
And we I'm part of a group called The Course Correction. We are a group of news commentators that, you know, we first got started just, we're like old friends who talk a lot about the news. But then when the George Floyd incident happened, we decided we wanted to try to put our voices out there as a group, you know, to join the conversation. And we're, our mission is to commentate on the news and look at what the corporate media is saying versus what independent media is saying, and trying to see if we can use that to figure out what's really going on in the world, what's why things seem to be going wrong in our country, and how to fix it.
Okay, so I know it's four of you guys, so let's see, we have Damian Patterson, who's who else do we have on the call with us today?
I think Chris should probably go first.
I'll go. Chris, hi, everybody. First, thanks a lot for having us. Much appreciated.
Thank you for coming on.
Most definitely. My name is Christopher. I also have a middle name called Michael, so that's what you might be seeing. So Christopher Michael Banks, proud member of this organization. When we, talking about myself, I've been a political junkie for, who knows, Lord knows, a long time. My mom was into politics. It was a hobby of mine. I didn't realize just how deep I was into it until I was speaking to people. And I'm like, you guys don't know certain things about these things. And they're like, again, not as in I'm better. I'm just surprised that you don't. Political discourse has always been something within the household, and so I'm used to speaking to people about it and used to hearing different different opinions. At one point or another, you could say my allegiance was, I was young and I was Republican at one point or another, and then I like switched allegiances in terms of what I became, and now I'm not affiliated because everybody sucks, and so But again, not to be so nihilistic about it. Talking to my friends is just something that we do. It's the usual thing. But I realize that a lot of the discourse that we have, I think a lot of people can sort of benefit from it. I think our voices do need to be heard. And especially with what happened with George Floyd, we definitely felt the need to speak up. So again, I'm just glad that we decided to do this. I think it's been years coming. We should have been doing this. But it's great that we are, and it's great to be here. So thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you for coming on. All right, who's next?
I guess I'll jump in. Okay. I'm Daniel McLean. Hello again. Third time. Thanks for having us. Where to start? I was shocked and honored to be brought into the course correction. I've known these guys for many, many years. We're all getting old, but we still have a lot to say. My political awakening was during the Clinton years, when I noticed how much the right attacked him, but I wasn't so much a political junkie as it was just a casual observation. I didn't really awaken to my political beliefs until the Obama years, when I realized I think I'm a leftist. I have some pretty progressive beliefs, but I feel we have a lot to say. We can add a bit of gallows humor to it, to the discussion, because there's a lot of darkness in our political climate, let's be honest. You know, this is the only developed nation that doesn't have a Medicare for all system. We can point and laugh at that, kind of ease the pain, but yeah, that's basically who I am. Much else to tell?
Okay, well, I think we have Stephen as the last introductee.
Hi, Stephen. Welcome back. Stephen was on before. Welcome back, Stephen.
Hello, thank you. Wow, great to be back. I guess we've actually known each other for over 2 decades now. So we've had many conversations, not just about politics, but life. One of the things that we'll probably get into talking about later is the need for men to actually gather and speak and to actually give to feed into each other as a in a world that constantly tries to take away from you. Mm-hmm. So that was part of the reason why we came together, and it's been great for that. My political awakening, I don't know if I've given it as much thought as everyone else has. I know that me and my father talk about politics on a regular basis, and we always have, but I didn't get too into it, I guess, until going to college and, you know, all of the discourse that comes along with college, but realizing that we had Rudy Giuliani as our mayor at around that time. And really being able to see his policies and how they were affecting the city that I was living in at the time, but also how he was being presented in the media and the disconnect there was there.
And absolutely.
I really started to dig into it and do more research from there.
Wow. Absolutely. Yeah.
And we'll get into all of that because Rudy Giuliani is in a class by himself. I don't know.
He's in a room. He's in a room. He's in a whole planet by himself.
So as Black men and political-minded Black men, and we always like to say politics is everywhere. I mean, it's in the amount of tax you pay. It's in the amount of alcohol you can buy, where your kids go to school. It's where you vote. It's every... It's
what you can eat. It's in what you can eat.
Decision we make. So when people say politics, we're all involved in politics, maybe on a small scale, maybe on a large scale, but we should all be aware of what's taking place in our country and within our politics. But I want to ask you guys, as a group, as Black men, as men, do you feel overlooked in politics and just in today's society? Do you feel overlooked, like your opinion and your value? How do you guys feel about that? Like your standing in society and in the political fray?
Can I take a crack at this one
first? Yeah, sure.
Please.
I think what's interesting about that is that there is both an our place in political society and American society in general is just we're both ignored and commodified at the same time. And it's amazing how our voices collectively our voices aren't really heard. They're heard as background noise to get people who believe a certain thing to continue to believe a certain thing. Like, oh, they're always complaining about something, but if they hadn't done blank, then this wouldn't happen. It's always, our voices are always used as a way of revalidating certain biases. But at the same time, our bodies are worth millions of dollars to people. We've got the fact that we have Black people in general, but Black men in particular, have had interactions with police for so long in this country, decades. Yep. Like we have been discussing and talking about publicly and privately, but publicly about our interactions with police officers. And I mean, it didn't even start with George Floyd. Clearly it didn't, but there's so many examples within the United States zeitgeist where Black men in particular have had these interactions, these dangerous and fatal interactions with police, and people have been speaking about it and our voices are just ignored, or you know, they're going to complain if you hadn't done such and such. It's always part of that. And then at the same time, they'll still tell you, well, you know, I don't think you should have a political opinion, just shut up and dribble, as particular white supremacist had said with her own media channel, right?
Indeed.
So yeah, so we're both in that sort of situation where like Rodney King was literally beaten on camera. Sean mm-hmm. Bell was murdered before his wedding.
The night before his wedding.
Right. Interactions with police officers that are fatal that we have been stating and screaming. And people are just like, you know, that's par for the course for their group. Mm-hmm. So now I think with George Floyd, it's like, oh my goodness, did you know these things happen?
If it wasn't for the quarantine, it wouldn't have been even seen.
That's another
I believe we were home, so we got to see it. Thank God for the quarantine. Like, right? Yeah. We had to get to see it.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, piggybacking on that, I feel like our voice is a bit of a commodity too in the political sphere when it comes to Black people are siding with X candidate. So they're relying on that. Like, well, we have the Black vote, but having the Black vote almost never translates to any tangible
power
to our community. Huh. It's just, it allows this person to get into power and enact whatever policies they want. Yeah. But after giving our voice to any particular candidate, we see no benefits to afterwards at all. Wow. So it's not just our bodies that are commoditized or our labor, it's also our voice as well. But just in so much as let's put this person in power and then forget about the people who put them
there. Right. All you gotta do is just go visit the Black church.
Yeah.
Pet some puppies, some babies. and that's been going on since.
Eat some chicken,
go to the picnic. That was happening in the 50s, the 60s. That was happening when Black people used to be Republicans, which we don't know. And then we moved over to Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. And it was the same kind of thing. They needed our vote. They always need our vote. We just don't know they need our vote. But now we realize.
And I know, I like what Michael had said. And when he was saying our bodies, because one of the only reasons you can enslave someone is if they committed a crime, and they use those Black bodies that are in prison. We have the highest rate of imprisoned people per our population size. We have so many Black men in jail, and their bodies are used to create products, to do manual labor. And it's because, like you said, they're a commodity. It's just, you don't want to give the just product or the just
compensation for the work that we're doing.
And I love that what you said too, but it's so true what somebody's gonna say, which a lot of people, which Michael has said, they want to find any reason to bother the Black male. But what they do is they over police in the Black neighborhoods where they don't police at all. And if you're in New York, out on Long Island, and all them places where meth is running amok, you don't go police out there, you police around the corner and say, oh, crack, what you put in our neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. Let me just be quiet. This is y'all show. Let me just be you put the crack in the neighborhood and then you say, oh, there's crack.
Look what they're doing. Look what they're doing. And it's so crazy. We don't want to take over.
Right, because I start getting angry.
I know, who was it that was speaking? Was it Damien or
Daniel. I think it was Daniel.
Daniel,
you were just saying something?
Oh. I was gonna say, to add on to what you were saying, Cindy, it reminds me, I feel we're ignored until we're not. Yeah. For example, there are calls for police reform or calls for social justice. Shut up, be quiet, know your place.
Yep.
Then there are riots, property winds up being destroyed, and suddenly, oh, let's put on this kente cloth and take a knee.
Oh God.
Let's take a knee for Gregory Floyd, who thank him for his sacrifice. I'm also reminded of LBJ, Lyndon B. Johnson. Yeah, he passed the Civil Rights Act, but he was also one of the most openly racist presidents we've had in our history.
Yeah, you're 100% right, because some of them do it, like when Lincoln, I was watching a documentary on Lincoln, he didn't free the slaves,
no,
just had a kind heart and wanted us to be free. It was a political move for him, and for him to win and keep the South, to put the South back in the Union. So it wasn't like he was like, oh, well, you guys are so great. And we overlook these things so much. And it's not taught in history. It's just, oh, he freed the slaves. But why did he free the slaves? Why did he?
He actually didn't even free them. He freed the ones where they couldn't go free. He said, if you stay in the Union, if your state stays in the Union and don't fight the United States, you can remain slave. You can still be a slave. Mm-hmm. But if you are in succession, if you are a rebel, then your slaves are free.
Wow.
So it's only punishing the ones that were going against him. If you had stayed in the Union, you could keep your slaves. Mm. So that's not even freeing anybody. I don't even use that verbiage. And by the way, I think it's Michael, you said you always loved politics. Mm-hmm. I had one of my gifts was the Emancipation Proclamation.
No, you know, oh my God. I'm so glad that you brought that up. I know I don't mean to get carried away with it, but
go ahead.
I've taught history before, and part of teaching the Emancipation Proclamation telling people that, like, look, students, you think that this is really great, but this was only conditional. If they came back, then you get to keep all your slaves, and all is fair. The only reason it went through was because the South was completely obstinate. Right. And they were doing their own thing. But I'm like, he didn't give a goddamn about black people, about slaves. He could care less. He was just using them as a tool. Again, another example of commodifying said black bodies, right? Wow. This country's based off. Like, there's a bottom black base that all of the power structure is based off of. And when you start talking about redistribution of wealth, you're like, oh, people start getting real uncomfortable. You know what? I'm not getting into that.
You guys have excellent points, because one of you guys said the shut up and dribble thing. Politics has been in sports since I can remember. I mean, you can't expect someone to not have a voice about what they believe in. When you remember, if you guys watch sports, Tim Tebow took a knee because that was what he thought he should do for religious purposes. And no one blinked an eye or thought that was wrong. Religion shouldn't be in sports either, if politics shouldn't be in sports, but they allowed it. They make exception. And I'm going to get off the soapbox, but I hate the fact that when they say, oh, you know, you shouldn't be doing this, this, and that, but we have politics, which is the flag and the anthem, which we're pledging to in our sports. So don't say the politics shouldn't be mixed in.
And then your chairman, your managers, your coaches shouldn't go donating to a specific party. They shouldn't go to the White House.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Y'all gonna have to say, shut up, Cindy.
Damien talk. He hasn't gotten in there yet.
Go ahead, Damien. You got to beat us down and get it. You have to get in.
So I kind of wanted to give a couple, because one of the things we like to do with our organization is give concrete examples.
Mm-hmm.
You remember how during the inauguration, President Biden was saying that he wanted to tackle white supremacy. But I was reading a report the other day about a Democratic congressman who's been requesting data for the FBI on white supremacy for over a year and still hasn't received it.
Wow.
Even during the Trump and in the Biden administration.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's all showmanship. We don't like to criticize our first Black President Obama and all of that. We don't like to criticize us, but all that stuff is just words. It's just words.
Yeah. Oh, Miss Cindy, I must correct you. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. The first Black president, according to the United States, is President Clinton. Remember when that was a thing?
Because
he smoked weed and played the saxophone on the Arsenio Hall show, so he's Black now.
You feed in those stereotypes and then you get mad at the stereotypes. Mm-hmm. You're feeding those stereotypes that we just want to be entertained, you know?
Mm-hmm. And that's the thing, when we in Black in America, just in general, one of the I was reading something and they said the reason it's so hard to get the freedom is because we stayed under our oppressors. When you look at Haiti, they kicked the French out of their country and it was like after they beat them, they kicked them out and they became a free Black nation. We're still held to the powers that be that enslaved us. And that's what makes it so hard to be a Black person in America. And people say, oh, America's not racist at its core. But when you think about when all these things were written, we weren't able to vote. We weren't. So yeah, it was racist because it was based on us being Black that we couldn't do certain things. And we're still fighting for those things. So the conundrum of being a Black man in America, what do you guys, how do you square your beliefs with still trying to achieve the American dream? How do you, that wasn't something we talked about, but being Black in America has to do with being an American and having that secession to, you know, participate in the scheme of things. So I don't know who wants to tackle that one, but.
That is actually very difficult. It's difficult to try to achieve the American dream as a Black man and as a Black person in America, because as far as the nation is concerned, we're not really Americans, are we? We're hyphenated people, and we don't have the same rights to that dream as white Americans do. They don't feel like you should have that home with the white picket fence and stuff like that. I just saw an article with or an interview with Cicely Tyson when she did the movie Sounder, and then she was talking to a critic of the movie, and the critic was highly upset at the scene where the young Black boy called his father dad. Like, the idea that Black people have the same family structures as white people just completely unnerved him to the point where he didn't want to finish watching the movie. Like, this Black boy should not be calling his father dad. That's what I call my father.
I was saying that to Tiff one time. We were talking about school, you know, educating. And I was like, I don't have any more patience for it, because at work, I used to get stupid questions about my hair. And things like, if my hair is short today, my hair is cut off, and then tomorrow I decide to get braids, and so my hair is all the way down here, and you're asking me, did I grow my hair? As if I'm not human, is that humanly possible for my hair to grow this long over the weekend? And I'm like, I don't feel like being bothered with educating you on hair. Like, you think we're not human. So saying what you said is just like, you think we're not human. We don't have human relationships. We don't have dads. Our hair doesn't grow regular like your hair grows. We're not human. You're just something different. Just how you look at kids as adults. You know, they treat children, Black boys, as adults. Yeah. You know, easily. He's an adult.
Young Black
because
girls
our bodies
too.
Develop very fast.
They see Black women too. They fetishize Black women too at young ages.
Yeah. I mean, the reason you have dozens of officers tackle a Black child for being disruptive in class.
Arrest them, put them in handcuffs. So you, one of the things we always like to ask Black men is about paternity issues. Because I have all boys, well, men. I have two men and a boy. Tiffany has a man and a boy. And one of the things I always say is, if he come home talking about somebody pregnant, I'm going to be saying, I need a test. What do you guys and that's because, you know, I've seen it be that women can obviously pin it on anybody, and the court system gets involved, and now I've seen men going to jail, men having gone, it can't be successful because of this thing, and can't even get their name off of something. So what do you guys think of the paternity issues?
Now, we're going to let them have at it. We just want to sit down.
Yeah. Damon, you've been kind of quiet. You want to tackle it?
Well, I'm one of the few people on here who doesn't actually have kids.
Oh.
So I don't know if I really have much to say on this particular topic, actually.
Don't worry. I also happen to be one of the people who doesn't have children, but I got a lot to say about that.
Okay.
But I'll cut it short. I'll keep it clean. So one of the interesting things I find is the root to all of this is still a form of sexism that people aren't recognizing. the form of sexism, it's like, it's all sexist ideology. This, the justice system is based off of a sexist ideology that, one, women are always better caretakers. No matter what the circumstance or situation, they're gonna always be the best situation. It's always great to keep the children with the mother. Father can have visitation or something, right? I don't know. But they, like, as long as he's bringing in the check, it's fine. But that in itself is a sexist ideology. It's based on sexism that women are always going to be the best nurturers, no matter what the situation or who they are. And so when you have a court system that looks at Black, getting particularly into Black men and women, but it, when you talk about men and women in general, they're always like, well, women, kids always have to be with the women. Doesn't matter. That's just the way it is. People don't even recognize, the judges don't even recognize that they are following this sort of sexist ideology without recognizing the individual situation. It's, yeah, well, children go with the mother, duh. But she doesn't have a home and she's been the abusive one and he's trying to get, well, we can figure out some sort of visitation. You're still not understanding the ideology of they shouldn't be with her. She should be thinking about getting a visitation to them. No. It doesn't go that way. Wow. Okay. And then from there, all rulings come from that. And you're like, and then don't even get me started on the fact that in terms of when it comes down to Black families, the idea that like your help, like, There was racism built into the help of if you're on some form of public assistance, you cannot have a man in the house because, you know, you're not allowed to have it in terms of public housing. So you're dividing people up. And then if you're found, then you can lose your housing, things like that. So you actually do have a lot of Black families that are out there. A lot of this terrible, stupid stereotype of men, of Black men not being Black, great Black fathers is, again, a stupid stereotype that America loves to run with. And there are quite a few people who have to game the system to be able to be around their families, but they're not living with them officially. They're not on the, like, on the lease, because to receive public assistance, you can't have this person. And then you have people who are snooping around trying to figure out, like, you know, trying to take your benefits away by investigating, literally hiding in bushes. Is that a man coming out of your house? Is it the father? Who's that? And so starting with that, it's just, sexism starts with it, then there's the racial lens that comes into it, and then so I already see it as just hypocritical. Once you go to court, you automatically know you're fucked. Excuse me.
I mean, we have a whole series in June dedicated to fathers and fatherhood, so you guys gotta definitely check that out. But the two fathers that are on, I guess, are Daniel and Steven. And I just want to say, you know, you guys, you get the crap into the stick when it comes to paternity, because if you're married and your wife goes, runs out and has a baby, it's automatically pinned to be yours and you're responsible. So that's, in and of itself, horrible. So how do you guys feel about, you know, just the paternity? And we're looking at, Cindy and I said we wanted to have a law or create something where it becomes law that as soon as the baby is born, there's a paternity test. So that way we can prevent these things from happening. You love me, I love you, cool, but let's make sure this baby is mine.
If we do that, we should obviously remove the stigma of requesting a paternity test, obviously.
Yes.
There's also the stigma surrounding it.
Yes.
This baby was just you're part of a happy couple and forming a family. There's always been the stigma, well, if you ask for a paternity test, well, now you're putting strain on the relationship.
Yep.
If we could remove that, then having a federal law that asks for a paternity test at the beginning of the child's life wouldn't be a problem.
Yes.
Because when I sit back and I think about it, ultimately, there is not a single man in the world who knows that he is the father of his child unless he gets that paternity test.
Right.
Because there's you can suspect, you can be 99% sure or whatever, you cannot be 100% sure until you've actually had that test. Nope. So seeing as how a child is born and courts want to make you financially responsible, we're living in a system, like Chris said, where you are rewarding families for being separate but penalizing them if they're together. It should just be a matter of course that the child is born, you have the paternity test, and then you move forward from there. You shouldn't be seeing horror stories of someone waking up and finding out, oh, I owe all of this money in child support because someone put my name on a birth certificate and I don't know this child and I've never even met the woman.
Yep.
How is that? How does that make sense? And then the court wants to enforce it even after it's been proven that I don't know her and I've never met her before.
Yeah. Like, yeah,
but your name's on it. Your name's on a piece of paper that you had nothing to do with. So there you go.
But when we were growing up, we were always taught mama's baby, papa's maybe. Right? But in my idea, I don't know if anybody ever really told me this, what it meant, but I always thought it meant he might be around or he might not be around. But when you think about it, it really shouldn't mean that. It means she's the baby, it's her baby, but it might not be his. It might not. Because you, like you just said, you really don't 100% ever know, especially since, you know, we all look alike. So you can't go by the looks of the baby. You can't go by the baby, what the baby look like. He looks just like him. He looks just like this one and that one. That never, I mean, if you watch Paternity Court, that don't always pan out either.
Like, yeah, and when you think about it, they do a battery of tests when the baby is born anyway. So why not stick it and say, okay, let's just do a DNA test. Add that to the plethora of tests that they have as well. And that way, for DNA purposes, for any type of hereditary issue, you want to know who the father is. Well, most people should want to know who the father is for protecting the man. And just, it's just so many, oh gosh.
Yeah.
And
I think part of the issue, just like Chris mentioned, is that fathers are not, ultimately, we're not really considered as important to the welfare and the raising of this child. Mothers are important. So when courts decide who the child should be with, they automatically think that the child should be with the mother. The mother is the better caretaker. So if you don't think that fathers are intrinsically important to the raising of this child, no one would ever think to say, oh, well, let's have a DNA test to see if this person's the father, because it's like, well, he's not important anyway. So whether it's him or whether it's not him, who cares? As long as this child is with its actual mother, that's all that's really important.
Right.
We need to move away from that thinking that one parent is just intrinsically more important than the other. And then we'll be able to start seeing changes.
Well, it's antiquated. Those are antiquated nuclear family back in the day, colonial times, whatever, when you had the mother home, the father went out to work, he went and killed some sort of boar and she cleaned it, I don't know. And then so it became this, it's not that anymore. So we definitely need to upgrade. And like I said, I'll take the heavy on if my son come home, and it's not because I'm questioning her, it's just because I've seen the tragedy of it, that you raise a child and find out it's not yours.
Yeah. And I think that's where we should start working on certain bills, or introducing, or talking to our Congress people to have them introduce those bills. I mean, it may not get a lot of support at first, but I mean, why not try it? Because a lot of men feel that way. I have 6 brothers, 2 sons, and a plethora of uncles, and I know they feel, and some of them have children that they're just like questioning. And, you know, unfortunately, I hate to say it, but unfortunately, some black men are afraid of the court system and afraid of going in there and taking the first step to initiate any type of action, because let's face it, the court system has never worked out all that great for us. I mean, we talk about Derek Chauvin and how he was found guilty in the George Floyd trial, but that's like few and far between. And I know that's never.
Segue
into that, because we were supposed to talk about a little bit about the trial too. So, I mean, what did you guys think about the verdict, the trial, how it was carried out? Whoever wants to take that.
I think it's a damning indictment of American society that we're all surprised at how the verdict went.
Yes.
It's like, we're surprised that the murderer who was caught on camera committing murder was convicted of murder. And this is a shock.
Yeah.
It's almost unprecedented.
It's not funny.
It's not funny, but it's true. It is
100%. It's just the truth.
Yeah.
We all like OJ. We like, what? I got on.
Yeah.
We like, what?
They still won't forget about that. My God, they keep bringing that up.
Yeah. I mean, this is probably the most watched trial since the OJ.
I told Tiff that. I said that to Tiffany. I said, the Rodney King, O.J. Simpson, and this one. This is our Rodney King, O.J. Simpson of the whatever century. And it's just, like you said, I think it's poignant that you said, we're shocked at the verdict.
Yeah, so absolutely shocked. Where were you guys when you, well, not, you don't have to give specific information, specific location, just in case you were somewhere you weren't supposed to be, but just say, what was your reaction when you heard it? I know I cried when I heard guilty. I was shocked and I cried in my car waiting for my Jamaican food, but it was shocking, like Daniel said, and it shouldn't have been, but it was, and I cried. So I'm going to go around. Let's start with Daniel, what was your reaction to and why?
A moment of disbelief, but only a moment, because there was so much outcry, even during a pandemic, global outcry, and video evidence. Yeah. I mean, it was undeniable. Now, Chauvin's defense tried to talk around it, saying, his having a knee on his neck for nearly 10 minutes didn't contribute to his death. He had drugs in his system. Secretly, he's not saying the quiet part out loud, but the quiet part is maybe he had it coming. Maybe he put himself in that situation. But yeah, when I heard the news, I thought to myself, yeah, that's how it would go.
Wow.
If I were caught on camera choking out an infant and I was put on trial, yeah, I'd go to jail.
Most likely, most definitely.
Yeah, whether I had a badge or not. But I also wondered when I got the news, how would this have gone if he wasn't recorded?
How many others have happened that weren't recorded, right?
Exactly, precisely.
Yeah. You know how it would have gone. So Damien, what were your thoughts on it?
So I was a little, cautious about it, I would say, in a sense that, you know, I was happy to hear the verdict, but I was also a little surprised that you said it was such an open and shut case. Mm-hmm. There really shouldn't have been any other possible verdict.
But I
worry also, like, I'm still waiting for the other shoe to drop, because I'm still worried about the possibility of an appeal,
right?
Based on that silliness they're saying about
Maxine Waters. Yeah.
Wow. I'm sorry, my camera. I'm sorry. But it's so crazy that we feel like shocked that we got a guilty verdict. I'm gonna ask Stephen and Michael as well for their reaction. But I wanna also go into what we term the systemic racism part of it, because I know you guys said you wanted to talk about that and discuss that. And part of the systemic racism is definitely vilifying this Black man who had a 20 and see, look at what he did. He asked for this.
Counterfeit money is a capital, it's punishment. Without a jury, without a trial, without anything.
Yeah.
Anything. So go ahead, Stephen or Michael, whoever wants to.
Well, I was surprised as anyone. And again, really shouldn't have been surprised. Everything was recorded and it was clear what was happening here. But we've lived in this country long enough to see that even when you have a Black man being murdered on camera, there's always this push to make him the reason for his own death. There's never a time in this country where it's like, oh, well, he was just a Black man who was walking down the street. It was always, well, he looked menacing, or he didn't do well in school. Did you know he used to smoke weed? There's always a attempt to throw dirt on him even before, you know, he's been buried. And I remember clearly that when we had the George Zimmerman case, Trayvon Martin, he was missing for a while. And all I kept thinking of that period of time between him being killed and his family being notified.
And he was a kid.
The attempt to look at his entire past to find the dirt necessary to make it seem like he deserved his fate.
Yes.
Because there's no other reason for you to have a dead teenager and it took you that long to notify the family. You were looking for a way to, and George Zimmerman wasn't even a police officer, but you were looking for a way to clear him of any wrongdoing before the news broke.
Do you remember, sorry, Stephen, not to cut you off, but do you remember when Fox News ran photos of Trayvon Martin? Yes. But it turned out to be a totally different person.
Oh yeah! Oh my God! Right. Oh,
he's all fucked out. He has a bandana.
I'm sorry, Daniel. It's faux news. FAUX.
Faux news.
Right. Faux news. Right.
Faux news.
I mean, we should.
It's a French show. It's faux. Like I could faux
call
pas.
It some. I could call it something else, but I want to respect your show.
Right. No. Hey, look, we grown on here. Faux news.
But Stephen, I'm sorry. Sorry to cut you off.
But this happens all the time. It's always a matter of, okay, this black man is dead. Let's find whatever it is in his past to
let's see what killed
dirt
him.
On him. And he's too dead to defend himself now.
Too dead.
That's the key. The key is to make sure that the black man is dead and unable to defend himself.
Right.
So that the worst things he's ever done in his life is now the thing that's going to define him. And it doesn't matter what his mom says about him, doesn't matter what his sisters say about him, it doesn't matter what the church says about him. All that matters is he smoked weed once. We got the evidence right here. So, you know, that would account for why these three men jumped out of a truck while he was jogging and decided that he needed to be shot dead.
Yes. And now it's covered up too. And you remember, we would not have heard about that had it not been for the protests that were taking place. No, not even the tape. It was the protests. People kept trying to get the DA to charge these people. And these, like with George Zimmerman, these are not even police officers. These are just regular citizens jumping out of a car to shoot and kill someone.
Yeah. Well, you know, two things. The purpose of Make America Hate Again is to make it go back to what it, when they say great, is when was it great is the question. Yeah. It's back when we had to present ID to walk. It's back when we had to ask permission and not look you in the eye. Like now they're criticizing the soldier that was Mace. They said, oh, he had the nerve to be questioning the police officer. You know, so it's always to try to, you know, you see the people in the swimming pool getting pulled out of the swimming pool because you're black. You're exercising because you're black. You know, Make America Hate Again. The goal is to bring us back to the old, good old days, the grand old party, bring us back to that time when we need permission to do things. And the second thing is with the police, I really want us to get to a point where we're not shocked anymore at what, to see the Chauvin on his knee. That is what they were trained to do. It is a function of the police. If you know the history of police, it is the function of the police. They were the slave catchers. So it is definitely not what we typically look at police and say, can you help me? His job is not to help you. It's to pretend to help you, screaming, look out, he's got a nug, and then shoot you. You know, that's what their job is to do. So they designed to, you know, police us and protect them and their property. White men, that's who they were originally designed to do, protect white men and their property. And I'm gonna shut my little mouth. Yeah, I'm gonna try.
We also have the idea that at any time, any white person will have the feeling that they can police you. Not just police officers with badges, just a guy in a Starbucks or a guy who sees you someplace where he feels you shouldn't be. They have the right to say, hey, what are you doing? Come over here and answer
my question. I
wish a mofo. Like, why do I have to answer your questions?
I'm going to piggyback off of what you said, Stephen, because, like, frankly, in a system of white supremacy, any white person can be deputized to dole out some form of justice. And we understand justice with the quotes, the air quotes. So at any time, when you see something, you have now been deputized by your whiteness to allow you to investigate, to find out what's going on.
If you see something,
do something. Right. What's that guy doing here? You don't belong here. We have a close-knit community here. Why was he in the neighborhood?
I've never seen you before. But like, it all goes back to the caucasity of the justice system and the fact that, like, again, you can be deputized to do whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm going to jump into that. Like, I don't want to be the rain cloud here, but I'm going to say that I was not surprised by the verdict. I was happy for the verdict because this time the 1% of times, and that's a statistic, the 1% of times where officer are actually indicted for any of the crimes that they commit, there's a 33% chance of that 1% chance that they can, that they're going to be prosecuted. And this was the 33% of the 1% that happened. And I'm like, oh, okay, so I guess we're due for it. Which means that this is going to be, I see this and I'm like elated for a couple of seconds. I already automatically know, oh, this is going to be the excuse not to do anything. Justice has been met, has been meted out. Okay, and this is where we've still got three other freaking murderers, who assisted murderers who need to catch some of that justice too. But this is where politicians will be like, and Nancy Pelosi did not disappoint. Oh, this is a part where the politicians will now commodify this fact. Oh, thank you, George Floyd, for sacrificing yourself on this. Oh, that got me so tight.
I can't.
This is back to the situation of, even when there is some form of justice meted out for finally some enforcer of this white supremacist sort of mm-hmm. ideology, the fact is they're still going to find a way to just tarnish it. And lo and behold, if it's not your annoying democratically elected leaders who are marring the situation with their idiocy and commodifying it, then you have the other enforcers who are like, that's way too much. This is just a symbol. Again, I'll tell you this. In law enforcement, it almost pays to do this because you automatically know that you're going to get this stupid blue wall, not necessarily science, but these fools who believe in the thin blue line are going to jump in. They're going to give you some sort of fund. They're all going to like shovel money towards you. You're going to become a millionaire the minute you kill a black person. And in the off chance that you actually get prosecuted and actually go to jail, which is this one situation, you're going to have faux news and other idiots who are going to be screaming and yelling and talking about appeal. And they're going to be looking at every single thing that every other black person does to justify getting that person out or justify meeting out the kind of justice that they felt George Floyd deserved, which it's so much to it. So again, I was like, oh, they actually did it. What do you know? And then I was like, oh, this is the part where they screw it up. And then like how many hours later, Nancy Pelosi comes out and opens her stupid mouth. And then like everybody else is like, we're going to appeal this. And like, we still got three more. And again, this is all still based off of white supremacy. So just because these white sacrifices were taken care of, it doesn't necessarily mean that we have now seen justice. I like to think it's a turning point, but you got to keep pressure on. And right. Even with the pressures when they don't listen to you.
That is 100% true. 100% true what you're saying. It's a break in the blue wall of silence. It's a break, but it's not, we haven't arrived. That's the key. We have not gotten to where we need to be. And the question is, what do we do? How do we break this systemic racism within America? And I feel in a lot of ways, we need to get people, everyday people that understand the system and understand the processes that mm-hmm. did not work. We need those people in power, not the ones that are millionaires or their fathers were mayors and all of these other things, but we need people that understand, that live the lives that are affected within their community. We need those people in power so that they can advocate for us as well. I mean, that's just one of it. So, I mean, what do you guys think about to break that systemic thing where, you know, we're not thought of in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, all of those things. We weren't thought of at that point. So we need to correct.
You were thought of as a thing, as a vine
of a thing.
I think that one of the things that we need to do is if we're going to keep being looked at as a commodity, then we should make our elected officials work for that commodity, because you're not allowed to just get things for free. You have to pay for it. So if you want my vote, I want something tangible for that vote.
Exactly.
I want the systems of white supremacy to be taken down.
Yeah.
First off, if the KKK is looked at as a terrorist group, supposedly, do something about it. Yeah. That's one of the tangibles I want. I want to see KKK members being arrested then. I want to see them being treated as domestic terrorists and being locked away. I want to see white police officers who are going around routinely murdering Black people. I want to see the kind of justice we got with Derek Chauvin. I want to see that on a regular basis.
Qualified immunity.
Yeah. Take that away.
Yeah. Qualified immunity. I want qualified immunity. I just want, I was thinking when you were talking about white supremacy, Tiffany and Michael, I think, were saying it. If you want what white supremacy looks like as a picture, you just frame the Capitol, build them climbing the Capitol and beating the hell out of they protectors and the people they hire to, you know, kill us. They thugged out whatever. You want that picture versus, you know, Ahmaud Arbery jogging and just getting shot for no reason. Or, you know, just think of anybody, Breonna, anybody. Just think of anybody. Have a picture of them and then have a picture of those guys scaling the fence and the police officers reasoning with them. Do you need water? Rittenhouse, when he shot, you know, those people to protest. Do you need water? Can I get you anything? So that's white supremacy. I am above you.
Yeah.
So I don't have to. Yeah. I'm above everything. I'm above the law. I'm above the rules of the road. I'm above reason. Yeah. So you just take a picture. I'm above anything. And how they was talking to those police officers at the riot, how they was beating them with their own flags, playing them out, punking them, spraying them. Just imagine two of y'all on the screen right now. Let's just say Damien and Daniel, y'all going down there to say you love Biden and you want to climb the wall of shame.
I was going to say just kissing goodbye.
Yeah, in 2 seconds.
I mean, I remember we had a Black woman here in New York who was arrested for attempting to climb the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
And she was they automatically streamed in and brought her down. I mean, she lived. This time she lived, but that was one Black woman climbing a monument and the police were on it.
Yeah.
As opposed to an army of insurrection coming to the Capitol. And they're like, we should give these guys water and a pat on the back, I think.
Yeah. Don't forget to tell them where they gave them a tour. They gave them a tour beforehand to show them where everybody's office was.
They made excuse. They made an excuse. They started making excuses afterwards for it. And they were warned, the FBI, the National Guard, they were warned beforehand, but they were warned of the wrong thing. They were looking for anti-Trump protesters, but I have friends that are Trump supporters, and I knew January 6th was not going to be a great day. So, and if they didn't know and take heed when they got the intelligence behind it, then I don't know what to say. I don't understand why you wouldn't take action and have the National Guard like you did in preparation. Yeah. For the Derek Chauvin trial.
No, when you had the people protesting, you sprayed the hell out of them and they was just walking in the park. Yeah. And how about the woman? There was a Black woman. I don't know if she was Black. She was a person of color down there, made a wrong turn and they killed her. And I think they sniped her, they shot her. She just made a wrong turn to look like she was going down there. I don't know.
In America, every street can be a wrong turn for a Black person.
Yeah, absolutely. But anywhere near the Capitol, please.
I was gonna say we weren't gonna take up all you guys's Sunday, so I'm gonna give each of you your last, you know, your whatever you want to have our viewers know, whatever you want to discuss or say or comment about, like what's on the minds of the political Black men that's on our our show today.
So I mean, I still want to go to that. The systemic racism issue, obviously that's a big thing.
Yes,
it covers a lot of different areas. If we're talking about just in terms of policing, I would personally like to see an audit of all of the police expenses in terms of and what their budgets are, because as I from what I've been reading, you know, since Ronald Reagan came in, he's the one who essentially boosted a lot of police budgets and militarized the police, giving them, you know, money and stuff that they don't really need to do their job.
Wow.
All that needs to be audited. They needed to see what they actually need, what they don't need, and give all the rest of the money to social services so that those people can respond to a lot of these calls that they get are really social service issues.
Wow. That is excellent, man. That's follow the money, as they always say. Follow the money, right? Follow the money. Anybody else want to add something or have they final?
I would like to urge any listeners to whatever your political affiliation to think critically. Always ask what, where, why, how. Just don't take things at face value. Trump was not, you know, a God king who will deliver us from, I don't know, whatever black hell we were going to pull the country into.
Right.
Biden is not the savior. He's not the son of God. You know, don't rely on any one person. Just work things out for yourself. You know, come up with your own solutions and always ask why. If you're given information, why would this work? Why are you saying this? How is this going to work? And know the history of certain topics too, because we're just repeating history in a lot of cases. Everything from the pandemic to voting rights, it's all a repeat of history. We've been here before. Yep. So that's what I'd like to add. We're going to be okay. Just
nice. Think. I like that. I like that. Who didn't? I think it was Stephen or Michael. Did you guys?
Yeah. I think I'll add that for any change to happen, there has to be some form of uncomfortability. If you are so used to a form of privilege, you start you start thinking that equality is oppression. And that is literally what's been happening. When you finally recognize that, and that's the problem, trying to recognize and see that you have a form of privilege without thinking, oh, well, you know, my father did this and I was able to do things. Yeah, okay. It's a form of empathy. I think that's the thing that we lack. It is this, it's atomistic individuality, where it's whatever works for me is what works for me, and I don't care about anybody else. Whatever works for me is fine. And then if I can work within a group that gets me resources, then I'm still cool with that because it's all about me. And that's having empathy, learning empathy is so freaking important. That's why, like, you really need to have good parents. And let's get onto the parent-attorney issue in terms of, like, having people and parents who give you a form of empathy and understanding. Empathy can make you understand that even if you're not black and not necessarily a person who's a person who's never been in trouble with the law, a person who says hi to officers and Officer McFriendly escorts you home, that you can recognize that there is a form of murder and that this is a lynching when you see somebody doing that. And that is only one example that you were able to see. You see this on the street all the time, that people who do not look like you or who do not have your same background have a totally different experience than Officer McFriendly that you're used to, that they have totally different experiences when you're in a neighborhood and you're like, I love this area. And they're looking at you like you just went over Miss Enid's house. You realize it, right? Like, what do you mean? I'm not an interloper. I paid fair value on this, on loans that I could get. Even though I'm a high school graduate, I don't have the same degrees that you have.
Wow.
And I have like a 400 credit score. I was still able to get loans. I don't understand. Why can't you? Like, so having a form of empathy can at least make you have a little bit more of a critical thought in terms of understanding that someone else doesn't have the same situations that you have. And that it is completely possible to have those two situations happen at the same time, running concurrently, and one person be really good to you and terrible to somebody else. And you're like, oh, that can happen. Empathy is what we're missing. There's a lot more I can go on about, but I'm going to shut up. But yeah,
that's nice. And we're gonna leave the last word to you, Stephen. As far as breaking the chains of systemic racism and trying to make notable change, what would you say or call for?
I think that the main thing that we have to remember about change is that it's hard work and that it's constant. The thing with this trial is that we're there's a real danger that people will sit back and say, justice was served. I don't have to do anything else. And that's exactly when the backsliding starts. If you want this change to be consistent and ongoing, you're going to have to keep this pressure on and keep working towards it. Change is not a thing that happens. Change is a thing that you constantly do and work at.
Yes. So,
if I can leave the listeners with anything, it's the fact that this is not the be-all end-all. This is your call to keep working and keep making things happen the way that they should be happening.
Mm-hmm.
Don't just rest on your laurels.
Wow, I always enjoy having guests that are insightful on, and you guys, you did a phenomenal job just giving a little bit of insight into the minds of not only Black men, but men in general, in the political aspects of what needs to change and what's working and what's not working. So you four should start a YouTube channel, the course correction. I mean, if you decide to do a YouTube channel, we'll come on for as guests, but we'll also support, and you know, it's the course correction, and there's so many different things that need to be corrected. So like I said, if you guys start a channel, definitely invite us on as guests.
First guest.
We're there.
Yes, we need to hear you guys' voices. We need to hear men, their voices. We don't want you guys in the background. We need to hear Black men. We need to hear men in general and listen and be receptive to what you guys are saying, because all of us together can make those changes and the course corrections that's needed. So, but guys, for being on with us. And
thank you so much.
Thank you guys
for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You guys are great. Thanks so much.
Yes, thank you. We're on 2PoliChicks on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and PoliChicks on YouTube. So follow us. Guys, have a good day. Good day.
Bye, guys.
Thank you so much, guys. You guys are great.
Bye-bye.
Don't hang up. We just wanted to debrief.